Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we're grateful as we come into your house, God, to experience your presence, Lord, and your power. Already, Lord, you've touched hearts and lives, God. You've healed physical bodies, God. You've given encouragement and strength, Lord, and we're grateful for that. God, we don't want to stop there. We want to go farther with you. We pray today, God, that as we open up your word, that you open it up to us, and also, God, that you open us up to receive it. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to have a good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown, and may it produce something in each and every one of our individual lives. And Lord, we'll praise you for that. We thank you for that. Today, we acknowledge that the Holy Spirit is the teacher of the church. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Be our teacher. Be our guide. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, the direction, even the correction we need for our lives. And Lord, we'll give you all the praise and all the glory and the honor for it. God, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves. Also, we'd ask it for all of our brothers and sisters in the Lord here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet that are preaching and teaching and hearing the gospel. God, we bless all of our brothers and sisters. Bless the Baptists, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalians, Charismatics, Pentecostals, God. We thank you for Calvary Chapel, Harvest, God, for Oak Valley, for The Way, Ecclesia and Trinity and Emmanuel Baptist, God. All the great churches that are out there, too many to name by name, God. We ask that you bless them. Bless our Catholic brothers and sisters and Adventist brothers and sisters, Foursquare denominations and assemblies, God, for Victory, God. All the great churches, God, we ask that you bless them as you bless us. Also, Lord, we don't forget our persecuted brothers and sisters scattered abroad throughout the world. We ask that you comfort them, strengthen them, encourage them, God. May they endure to the end. And Father, we ask for comfort right now for the nation of France. We ask for the people of Paris, God, that you protect them, God, that you strengthen them and encourage them, Lord. We ask for the people of Syria and Russia and Ukraine, God, that you halt these wars, Lord, that you protect and preserve lives, God. And that, Father, that most of all, you uphold the cause of the innocent, Lord, the fatherless and the widow, God. You are the defender of the fatherless and the widow. So, God, we ask that you wrap the everlasting arms around the nations right now, God, and that you encourage them, God, that you strengthen them, Lord. May you turn this around to the glory of God, and may salvation be brought from it. God, we ask that you send laborers into the harvest fields right now, God. They are ripe and white for the harvest, but the laborers are few. So add to the laboring force, God. Send them out, God. We pray, Lord, that you strengthen the churches in these areas, God. May they rise up. Lord, I know of two churches in France, God, and I pray for them now by name. I ask for Hillsong Paris, as well as for Pastor Thierry and Sylvie Bonhomme, God, that you strengthen them. Encourage them, God. May they be a light shining in a dark place in this time, Lord. We ask for in Ukraine, for Pastor Zhenya and Vera, and for Hillsong Kiev, God, and for all the churches that are there, Lord, for Dynamo Church, God, we pray your strengthening and your encouragement in their hearts and in their lives, God. And Lord, in Syria, God, in Lebanon, God, we ask for mutual faith, God, in the Life Center, Lord, that you protect them and bless them during this time. And God, we call for the salvation of ISIS and ISIL, God. We ask, Lord, that you would bring about miraculous conversions, God, that by the thousands, God, and by the millions, Lord, that they would come to the faith, God, and that you would turn this thing around, halt their murderous ways, God, the fanaticism, God, and we pray that you preserve lives, God, but more than that, God, we ask for their salvation, God, we ask for their repentance, we ask that they would fall down at the feet of Jesus and declare that he alone is God and that he is good, and Lord, we thank you for what you're going to do in Jesus' mighty name. Everybody in agreement shouted, amen. Hallelujah. We ought to pray those bold, outlandish prayers. God wants us to get in faith. God is so good. I'd like to open today's message by telling you a story that happened to me when I was in my 20s. I was in a Christian rock band. We traveled around a little bit. Didn't do too much. Didn't go too far. In fact, when I got out of the band, they cut an album and started doing some stuff. I thought, why didn't you guys do that when I was in the band, you know? Had to wait until I get out to start doing some fun stuff. But anyways, we were at a point in the band's, you know, career, if you will, that we had lost a drummer, and so we were looking for another one. And through a mutual friend, we had found a guy. And, you know, so we set up a time we wanted to meet him, just talk to him, see if he was a godly person, if he was, you know, really a Christian in his conduct, in his life. And so we said, hey, we're going to meet you in Riverside. We'll meet at this little coffee shop and a little place that we all like to go to. And We got all of our gear, got our guitars and everything, and went out there to the coffee shop, set up, and we're waiting for the guy. Well, we're waiting for the guy. You know, we have guitars, so might as well play, you know? And so we start jamming, start having a good time, and after a little while, a guy comes, sits down next to us, and he sees the guitars and listens to us, kind of, you know, bobbing his head along, and after a little while, there was a kind of a lull in our time, and he leans over and he says, hey, you guys play any classical gas or anything like that? Now, myself, being a product of two hippies from the 60s, I knew exactly the song he was talking about, and, you know, I was well-versed in that music, and you know, that's kind of a hard song to play, You know, so I said, I can't play that song. Can you play the song? He goes, yeah, let me see the guitar. And he picks it up, he starts jamming. I'm going, man, that's cool. You know, so I said, hold on a second. And I grab another guitar and we start jamming, playing along. He's doing leads and little riffs over what I'm doing. Man, we're having a good time. And after a little while, I start to share, you know, just what we're about and what we're doing. You know, he could tell that we were a band, so he's asking me about the band. Yeah, we're Christians, you know, and we go to churches and we play and we've done little shows and different things like that. Here to meet a drummer. And he kind of says, oh, okay, yeah. And so the question was begging to be asked, well, what do you believe? Are you a Christian? He says, oh, yeah, you know, I used to be. I was really deep involved for a little while, but some things happened in life. Living with my girlfriend, and, we ended up having a baby out of wedlock, and the organization I worked for at the time was a Christian organization. They found out, and they fired me. I almost came over the desk at the guy, too. You know, I was just so mad. I was so angry. I couldn't understand why Christians would act that way. And he went on to say that eventually his anger turned not only against that organization that he worked for, but against the church itself. All he saw was judgment. All he saw was criticism. All he saw was condemnation. He didn't understand why they would do that to him, why they would keep him out, and what that had to do. He said, you know, why would they stick their nose into my business? That's my personal business. That's my personal life. They don't need to know anything about that. And so why would they fire me for that? And then eventually his anger turned not only against the organization and the church, but now it started to turn towards God. And he sat there in front of me with a guitar in his lap, and he said these words to me. He says, I don't understand how God could be true. I don't believe in a God that would ask a man to sacrifice his only son. When I had my baby, I would never do anything to hurt my child. And so why would God ask Abraham to sacrifice his only son? And how could Abraham be so stupid as to blindly follow God and try and carry out that act? He says, I don't believe in a God like that. And today, maybe you came into this place and you've had that same question on your mind. Maybe you've had hurts and pains. People in church have hurt you, or they've judged you and criticized you. You feel like you're condemned. And today you came into this place with questions on your mind. Maybe you've looked at things in the Bible that seem contradictory and you just don't understand it. And you've concluded that I don't understand this about God. I don't know why. I don't know really what's going on. Today, I want to help you to reach a different conclusion. In fact, the title of today's message is The Godly Conclusion of Faith. Reaching a Godly Conclusion of Faith. Hebrews the 11th chapter. We've been in these verses in Hebrews chapter 11, verse number 17 through verse number 19. Talking about the same story that this man at the coffee shop was grappling with. Hebrews chapter 11, verse number 17 says this. It says, by faith. Everybody say, by faith. By faith, by faith Abraham, when he was tested. See, Abraham had already reached a godly conclusion. He was in faith, and so when he was tested, he was able to do something. Let's take a look at it. It says, when he was tested, offered up Isaac. And he who had received the promises offered up his only begotten son. Now, the terminology there in the original language is as if Abraham had already gone through it. As if he actually had sacrificed Isaac, even though we know the rest of the story, that the angel of the Lord stopped him before he could carry it out. And it goes on to say this, of whom it was said, in Isaac, your seed shall be called. So in other words, there was a promise about Isaac, and Abraham was carrying out this act, even though if he sacrificed his son, the promises that God had given wouldn't have come to pass. Why would he do such a thing? How could he do that? How could he sacrifice this blessing that God had given him? Was he foolish? Was he blindly following the Lord? Or was something else going on? We find the answer in the next verse, verse number 19. Notice that there's no period. This is not a new sentence. This is the same thought, the same breath. Take a look at verse number 19. It says this word, concluding. Everybody say concluding. See, we're all going to come to conclusions in our lives. You might think God is unjust. You might think God is unrighteous. God is not good. I can't believe in a God who would allow the suffering and the pain on the earth that he allows. Why doesn't God do something? And you've reached a conclusion that is not godly. But here, Abraham, we find out that he was able, even though it didn't line up with the natural thinking, even though he had received the promise that it was long awaited. Now he had a conclusion, and it was a godly conclusion of faith. Look what it says, concluding that, look at this, God was able. In other words, he had already made up his mind about God. That even though here he is taking the promise, taking the long-awaited son and sacrificing him, he had concluded God was able to do something. What did he conclude that God was able to do? Look at this. Concluding that God was able to raise him up, even from the dead, from which he also received him in a figurative sense. Now that word figurative, we understand that it was an image, that it was a type, right, in the Old Testament. In fact, the original language, the word is parabole, where we get our word parable. It literally means to throw something alongside something else. So here we see that Isaac was a story. He was a picture coming alongside a truth from God. Now, to speak a story and to illustrate something to Abraham, but not only to Abraham, to each and every one of us. Isaac's life told a story. He was the only begotten son of the Father. Notice that Jesus was the only begotten son of God. Even though Adam was called the son of God, now here comes the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and full of truth. So here Isaac is, and even though there was an Ishmael that came before, Ishmael was an illegitimate child because he did not come through Abraham's wife, Sarah. And so Abraham had to cast the bondwoman out with her son, and he had to trust God and believe God for this heir, this Isaac, and for seed to come, that the promises of God would come through Isaac. Now, in the same way that we find here Isaac carries the wood that he's about ready to be sacrificed on, Jesus carried the wood of his cross. Isaac was bound, and he was laid on the altar of sacrifice. In the same way, Jesus was laid on the cross and nailed to the tree, and there he hung. We find that Jesus died and was in the grave for 3 days. In the same way, Abraham and Isaac traveled for 3 days to get to the Mount Moriah. And that mountain was the same mountain where Zion would be placed thousands of years later. And here Jesus would come and sacrifice his life there on Calvary's Hill. Finally, we see that Abraham was about ready to slay his son, his only son. God stopped him, but Jesus was the Lamb of God who was slain, and he laid down his life, and just as Abraham received back his son who was as good as dead, in Abraham's heart, it had already happened. And yet now here Jesus comes, and he is raised from the dead. It did take place, and Jesus was not figuratively raised. He was literally raised. He came, he died, he was buried in the ground, and he was raised again to life, and now he lives forevermore at the right hand of the Father. God received him back from the dead. So essentially, we see that the story that God was telling Abraham was the gospel itself. In fact, you'll find in the book of Galatians, if you want to turn there with me, Galatians, the third chapter, that this is spelled out very plainly for us, that Abraham actually believed the gospel of Jesus Christ. Turn there with me, Galatians chapter 3. It would be good if you want to dive more into this, to take some time this week and read through Galatians chapter 3 and into Galatians chapter 4. And while you're at it, you might as well read 5 and 6 as well. You know, they're all good. But if you want to study more on this, just Galatians chapter 3 and go into chapter 4. But I want to take a look at two verses for time's sake today. Galatians chapter 3, verse number 8 and verse number 9. Look at what it says. And the scripture foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith. You know, the Gentiles, anybody who's not part of the Jewish nation. They were outside of the covenants of God or the agreements of God that God had with the Jewish nation. So the scripture foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles, the people that were outside. That's most of us in this room. Most of us are not Jews in this room. And therefore, it says that God would bring us into the covenant. God would bring us into the agreement. How? By works? No, by faith. See, we'd have to reach that godly conclusion of faith. Look at what it says. It says, preach the gospel to Abraham. Wow. Beforehand saying, in you all the nations shall be blessed. You remember, Abraham believed God and it was accredited to him for righteousness. It's no different with us today. Look at this, verse number 9. So then those who are of faith are blessed with believing Abraham. So we understand now that when we believe the gospel by faith, now we are receiving the same blessing. It's accounted to us as righteousness in the same way that it was for Abraham. So for all of our lives, we need to reach that godly conclusion of faith. You might be saying, but Pastor Dan, it's hard. How do I do that? I don't understand. I don't see what it is that I need to do. How can I get that same conclusion that Abraham received? I'm glad you asked the question. I'm going to put a statement up on the overhead, and we're going to complete the statement three times today and find out, in order to reach a godly conclusion of faith, what we must do. Okay, a couple of things for us today. If you're taking notes, you can write this statement down, and then we're going to complete this statement three times today and find out, in order to reach a godly conclusion of faith. First one is this. In order to reach a godly conclusion of faith, we must die to the flesh. We have to let go of the natural, just like Abraham let go of his son Isaac there on the altar. We have to let go of things in the natural. God is a supernatural God. And the works of the flesh cannot produce the promises of God. In fact, the flesh is in opposition to the Spirit. Is that right? You'll read that in your Bible, the book of Galatians, as a matter of fact. And so here Abraham is, and in his heart, he had already given up his son Isaac. He bound him. He had the knife. His hand was outstretched, and the angel stopped him before he could go through with it. But Isaac, in Abraham's heart, was as good as dead. He had already let go of things in the natural, and he was allowing God to move and to do something supernatural. See, it's easy for us to try and produce the things of the Spirit by way of the flesh. Is that right? Maybe you see a promise in your Bible. Prosperity. Oh, that's a good promise. Then, Lord, you take pleasure in the prosperity of your servants. And what do? We go out there and we try and do everything we can do. We try and produce it in the natural. Man, I'm going to go out there and I'm going to hustle. I'm going to make this happen. I'm going to work hard. Now, there's nothing wrong with that because there's principles in the Bible of working hard that the diligent hand shall be made rich. The diligent hand shall rule. The sluggard puts his hand in the dish, but he can't even bring it back to his mouth. He's so lazy. And like a door turns on its hinges, so is the sluggard in his bed. And he cries out, there's a lion out there in the streets, always making excuses. So I'm not getting down on getting out there and making something happen and working together with the promise. But if you're trying to do it in the flesh, it's not going to work. In other words, if it's only your natural and there's no God in it, it's destined to fail. And yet, oftentimes, we'll take what it is that we thought was good. God, I saw a promise. God, I saw in your word that you want me to be happy. God, I saw that you want me to be blessed. God, I saw that you want me to have a godly husband or a godly wife. And so what do? We go out there and we try and make that happen in the natural, right? And yet, do you remember that Adam was asleep when God made Eve? Hello? See, Adam could not produce Eve in the natural. God had to do something supernatural and put the dude to sleep so that he could grab the rib, all right, and he could form and fashion the woman and then bring the woman to Adam. Nothing Adam could do in the natural to make that happen. Couldn't produce an Eve by the works of the flesh. It had to be a supernatural experience that God would form that woman and bring her to him. You know, oftentimes we try like Abraham did. You remember what Abraham did? Here he was, and he saw the promise of God. He saw that he was supposed to have a child. And so what did he do? He's trying to make this happen, trying to make things work. The promise tarries. It's a long time. He's waiting and waiting, and Sarah's just not getting pregnant. So after a while, what does Sarah do? Sarah says, here, take my handmaiden. Maybe this is what God wants to do, right? And so in the natural, in the flesh, Abraham produces a child with Hagar, the handmaid, not with Sarah. Even though God said, no, Sarah will conceive and bear you a child. And this was his wife. So now here Abraham has a child. And Abraham takes the child in Genesis, right? Abraham starts taking the child and he says, God, he's talking to God. God's giving him promises. And God says, your wife is going to bear a child. And look at what Abraham says. In Genesis chapter 17, verse number 18 and verse number 19, Abraham said to God, oh, that Ishmael might live before you. What is he saying? He's saying, God, don't you see what I did? I had a child, just like you said, God. Here it is. Here's what I produced, God. Now look at the response of God in the next verse, verse number 19. Then God said, no. We don't like that answer, do we? God, will you bless my business? God, will you bless this relationship? God, will you bless what I want to do in my ministry, God? God, I'm out there doing this for you. God, you said, God, you gave me a promise. God, will you bless it? But if you're working in the flesh, God's answer is no. No, Sarah, your wife, shall bear you a son. And you shall call his name Isaac. You know what Isaac means? Isaac means laughter. Why Isaac? Because when Abraham heard the promise of God, he laughed. He said, shall an old man like me bear a child? Shall Sarah, this old lady, is she going to nurse children? And he laughed. You ever had a promise from God that was laughable? God told you, I'm going to use you to reach people. He said, what? God, what? Me? Me from the IE? God, not, you know, God, you know where I live. God, you know my mama. And let's not even get started on my daddy, right? You know the friends that I hung out with. And you know the streets that we came off of. God, you want to use me? You ever had a promise from God that was laughable? God, I'm not educated. God, I'm not smart enough. God, I'm not cool enough. I'm not from the right area. I'm on the wrong side of the tracks, God. Ain't no silver spoon in my mouth. It's a broken plastic spoon, you know? Drinking out of Dixie cups growing up. God, you want to use me? What? And you laugh. But see, God is saying it has to be something that's so great that you cannot produce it in the flesh. It's going to be laughable in the natural. And it's okay to marvel. It's okay to wonder. It's okay to rejoice and laugh. But it's not okay to try and produce the promises of God in the flesh. Are you listening today? Come on now. I'm preaching good. Hallelujah. See, God had to get Abraham's mind off the natural. He says, I will establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant and with his descendants after him. So you can't have an Ishmael and present it to God. I had a book that I wrote for Freedom for Our Future, children's book. Man, I went after it. We struggled. We wrestled. We tried to make this thing happen. My prayers were, God, will you bless this children's book? God, I pray that you double and you triple my Freedom for Our Future pledge into my hand through these book sales, God. I receive it. I believe it, God. And I'm just presenting God my Ishmael. God, here it is. God, I'm doing it. God, we made the book. You know what God said? Nah. You know how much money I made on that book? Big fat donut. Nothing. Why? Because God says, that's not how I'm going to do this, son. It was fun. It was a good time. People are enjoying it. You know, I see a post on social media, little kids in schools and stuff reading the book. That's awesome. That's awesome. But the money I have invested has not returned yet. Hello. God says, that's not how this is going to work. I got this. I will take care of this. You don't have to worry, son. But see, when you start to do things in the flesh, it's an Ishmael. You know what God said about Ishmael, right? He told Hagar, Ishmael is going to be a wild man. That word wild man, every time you find it in the Old Testament, it literally refers to a wild donkey, or the Old King James Version says an ass. And it says, his hand will be against everybody, and everybody's hand will be against him. See, when you operate in the flesh, you'll end up looking like a jackass, mad at everybody, and everybody's mad at you. Anybody other than Pastor Dan have that experience, right? Start working in the flesh, and all people hear is, right? You walk around, man, I don't understand what's wrong with her. You all are crazy, right? And then you leave and they say, thank God he left, man. He was acting like a donkey. But that's what the flesh will produce. The flesh cannot produce the things of the Spirit. They're not going to work. Not going to work. We've got to get out of the natural and get into the supernatural power of God. Are you listening today? Say amen if you are. So in order to reach a godly conclusion of faith, first of all, we have to die to the flesh. Just like Isaac was sacrificed there on the altar, we got to die to the natural. Can't present God with our Ishmaels. We got to go with the Spirit of God and the way of God. Which brings us to number two is this. We must die to the wrong paths. Got to die to the wrong paths. See, people say that faith is blind. You just believe whatever God said without any basis. No, we have a basis. It's in the Word of God. And faith is not blind. In fact, I can see better by faith than I can in the natural by sight. And even though in the natural I may not be able to see how it's going to work out, I might not be able to calculate and add up in the natural what's going to take place, but by faith I can see the promises of God and I can walk by faith and not by sight, and I can receive those things that God has promised me. But I have to die to the wrong path. I can't go my way or the way that I think or the way of the world. I have to go God's ways. And oftentimes, it will not line up with our thinking. But if the command of God to obey contradicts the promise that God gave you, then you go with obedience and you let God take care of the promise. Hello? See, Abraham had Isaac, the promise. He received the promise. But what had not yet happened was that out of his seed, all the nations of the earth would be blessed. And God had told him, in Isaac your seed shall be called. And therefore, Isaac had to get married and have children, and out of those lines would come the Messiah. But now here God asked Abraham to sacrifice your son, your only son, Isaac. Now, Abraham could have said in the natural, God, that doesn't add up. If I sacrifice Isaac, there will never be that godly seed and Messiah can't come. God, you're crazy. God, that must not be you. God, what are you doing? It doesn't make sense. And yet we find that Abraham went ahead. Why? Because it wasn't about Abraham's way. It was about God's way. We need to regard God above the blessings of God. We got to get a hold of this. Because if God blesses our life and we take that blessing and we hold on to it and we love it so much that that blessing takes an exalted place above God, that has now become an idol. And God said, you shall have no other gods before me. I am a jealous God. See, God wants everything. Why? Because God knows he deserves everything because he is everything. And he's not some egotist wanting to be worshipped because he needs his ego stroked. No, it's because he is who he says he is. He's worthy of our hearts. He's worthy of our lives. He's worthy of the highest place. We have to regard God above all else. I don't need the blessings. I need God. I don't need money. I need God. I don't need fame and fortune. I need God. I don't need man to know my name. I need God to know my name. I don't want my name written here on earth. I want my name written in heaven because God is who he says he is. So that means I got to find the pathway of God. Not my own path. Not the way I think. Not the way the world says. I got to find God's paths. Remember Jesus, when he came, every time he'd start talking about going to the cross, people started scratching their heads. I don't understand, Jesus. What is this all about? And he says, I have to go. I must go. He actually told his disciples one time, let this sink down into your ears. Kind of like, let this penetrate your thick skulls, you Neanderthals. Everybody thinks Jesus was Mr. Kissy, kissy, huggy, huggy, lovey, lovey, man. He had some very harsh and pointed things to say. He did it all in love. He loved people enough to tell them the truth. And he said, the Son of Man must go to Jerusalem, suffer and be beaten and crucified. But then he will rise again on the third day. You remember people always, no, not you, Jesus. They didn't understand it. They would think he was talking about something else. And they couldn't comprehend it yet. In fact, one time, Peter steps up to him, pulls him aside, and says, now listen, you stop this foolishness. You're not going to the cross. And starts to rebuke Jesus for saying he's going to the cross. You remember what Jesus told him, right? He said, get behind me, Satan. In other words, you're standing in the pathway, and I need you to get out of the way so that I can keep going on with the way of God. So you got to die to the wrong path. The devil had already tried to give him another path. Just fall down and worship me and I will give you the authority over all the nations. The devil had that right at that time because Adam had already given the keys of authority over to him. And yet Jesus says, no, it is written, you shall worship none other than God, shall have no other gods before me. And so he died to the wrong path, and he took the path. He said, remember, let this cup pass from me, Lord. And yet, not my will, but yours be done. See, Jesus died to the flesh, and he died to the wrong paths. Same thing with us. John chapter 12, Jesus is speaking about the same thing. John chapter number 12, I want you to take a look at verse number 24 with me. Jesus is talking about going to the cross. He starts to reveal the plan and the path that God has laid out before his feet. And in John chapter 12, verse number 24, he makes a statement. John chapter 12, verse number 24, he says, most assuredly I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it produces much grain. Now that doesn't make sense to us in the natural. We say, well, wait a second, why does it have to die? Well, what's wrong with that? Can't we just put a seed in some water, put it in some sunlight, and it'll produce something? You might be able to get those results in the natural, but here Jesus is not speaking about natural things. He says, I want you to take that grain of wheat. I want you to plant it in the ground. It's got to die. In fact, we bury our dead under the ground. Is that right? So he says, I want you to put that seed into the ground and cover it over with dirt. It is unseen. And you cannot make this happen in the natural. See, as long as you hold on to it, as long as you have it in your hand, it will never produce anything. But the moment you allow that thing to go into the ground and die and you cover it up, it's out of your sight and it's out of your control. That's when the miraculous power of God takes something that was dead and it puts the resurrection power of God in it and it becomes alive and it sprouts up and it comes forth and it produces much grain. See, some of you guys have had dreams and visions that were so great, so laughable, you tried it in the flesh and when it didn't work out, you stopped. And yet God is saying, die to the flesh, but not only that, die to the wrong path. It's not going to happen your way. It's not going to happen the way that you thought. It's going to happen the way that I say it's going to happen. And so as you release that thing from your hand and you place that thing in the ground, you let it go. Now, God can hit it with the power of God, cause it to come alive, cause it to spring forth, and cause it to produce fruit. Faith's conclusion will produce faith's confession. In other words, you can tell where people are at. Because if people have made up their minds about God and about the path, then they will start to speak it. You will hear it out of the abundance of the heart. The mouth does what? Speaks. Therefore, faith's conclusion will produce faith's confession. We see this in the life of Abraham. Remember what Abraham said. Here they are. They're traveling. They're on their way to the sacrifice. Isaac's there. They've got young men with them. And look at what Abraham says in Genesis chapter 22, verse number 5. Then Abraham said to his young men, stay here with the donkey and the lad and I will go yonder and worship. And look at what he says. And who will come back? Me by myself, because I'm about ready to sacrifice my son, guys. So just leave it alone. I'm sorry, is that what your Bible says? Who's going to come back?
We.
Who?
We.
Come on, everybody. Who's coming back?
We
will come back to you. In other words, Abraham had settled it in his heart already that he wasn't coming back alone. He was coming back with his son Isaac. Well, how could he do that if he knew he was going to slay his son? Remember verse number 19. Because he concluded that God was able to raise Isaac up even from the dead. Now, I could have faith because I've seen enough superhero movies to believe that if I slashed my son's throat, that God would do that supernatural healing power thing where you watch it and the thing just kind of folds up and the flesh kind of restores and all the blood is gone, right? And then he raises up, I'm alive. You know, I can have faith for that. I can believe God for that. But that's just surface level because Abraham wasn't believing God for that. Abraham had a word from the Lord to take your son and sacrifice him as a burnt offering. Not just to slice his throat. That was just the first part. The second part was, remember, Isaac had wood and they had fire. So Abraham knew, because he'd given sacrifices before, that the burnt offering was one that after you slayed the animal, that you then took the fire and you burnt it completely until it was totally consumed to nothing more than ash. So Abraham wasn't believing for that superhero healing power from God to come and just sew up the wound. No, that would have meant that Abraham would have sliced his son's throat, poured out the blood on the altar, and then burnt him to ash, and that God would have to take that ash and form it together like he did Adam in the garden, and then breathe the breath of God back into him and raise him up out of the ashes. That was the faith that Abraham had. He concluded that God was able. Church, God is always greater than we know. God is always greater than we can believe for. God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we could ask or even think. We have to choose God's path. Abraham knew that God was able to produce Isaac through Sarah, and that if he could produce Isaac through Sarah in a dead womb, then if he slayed his son, that he would raise him up even from death. Now, how did he know that? How did he reach that conclusion? That brings us to the last one for today. Reaching a godly conclusion of faith. First of all, we have to die to the flesh. We have to die to the wrong paths. Finally, for today is that we must account for the character of God. Just like Abraham did. We must account for the character of God. Abraham knew the character of his friend. Think about it for a second. Abraham had left everything to follow the word of God. He left his home. He left his comfort. He left his income, his wealth. He left his family. He left Egypt and the pleasures of sin that were down there and the comfort. He left everything to follow God. Here was a wealthy man. He had hundreds of servants born in his own house. He had flocks so great that him and his nephew couldn't even stay on the same plot of land. They had to separate. He left all of that and didn't even have a place to call his own. He was dwelling in tents. The only plot of ground he ever owned in the promised land was a burial plot for his wife and himself eventually. That was all he had. He left it all. And yet, here, when God shows up at Abraham's door, what does he do? He runs to prepare a meal for God because God was his friend. Because God was faithful. Because God had never, never failed him. When God's about ready to leave, he stops and he says, well, wait a second. Shouldn't I tell my friend about what I'm about to do? Abraham, I'm about ready to wipe out Sodom and Gomorrah. What do you think? Abraham starts to intercede for Sodom and Gomorrah. God, if you had just 10 righteous, would you spare the land? I would spare the land for 10, Abraham, because you asked. See, this was the friend of God. And therefore, when God said, Abraham, I want you to take your son, your only son, Isaac. Abraham didn't exalt Isaac above God. No, why? Because he knew the character of God. That God was good. God was not mean-spirited. God was not playing a joke on him. God was not trying to be vindictive or vengeful. But that God was good. And therefore, even if Abraham carried out the sacrifice of his son, that God would bring him back. Because God was good. And this was his friend. And in our lives, when you take a look at the suffering in the world, when you see injustices happening all around you, when you wonder about your life and you say, where is God in all of this? Why did this have to happen? You need to stay out of the flesh, stay off the wrong paths, and account for the character of your friend. Do you know that you are beloved now? That's an endearing term of God. God counts you as the bride of Christ. Remember, God is the perfect husband, and therefore he loves his wife. He laid down his life for the church, sacrificed his only begotten son. He didn't ask Abraham to do anything that he wouldn't do. But only he stopped Abraham before he carried it out. But God didn't withhold his son from us. He didn't stop Jesus there on the cross and say, okay, Jesus, that's okay. You can come down now. No. He turned his faith and the wrath of God was poured out on Jesus. And that's why Jesus cried out and said, my God, why have you forsaken me? It's because he took the punishment for our sin. And so when you're going through pains and trials and tests, account for the character of God, just like Abraham did. Remember Abraham, when he was looking at this situation, Genesis chapter 22, verse number 8. Isaac says, Father, I see the sack, you know, I see the wood, I see the fire, but I don't see the sacrifice. And look what Abraham says about God, the one who he knew his character. Abraham said, my son, God will provide for himself a lamb for the burnt offering. So the two of them went together. Now, Isaac is just like Jesus in the sense that Isaac knew the character of his father. And he knew that Abraham was a good man. And he knew that even though there wasn't a sacrifice, and you know, Isaac's probably not dumb. Some scholars believe that Isaac was anywhere from 16 years old all the way up to 33 years old, the same age that Jesus was when he was crucified. And therefore, Isaac would have known. And that question is not just, hey, Dad, where's the lamb? It was, Dad, I see the wood. I see the fire. Daddy, you're carrying a knife. Been mighty quiet on this trip, Dad. Where's the lamb? Look at what Dad's response is. God will provide for himself a lamb for the burnt offering. They might have locked eyes. Tears might have welled up. And Isaac submitted himself to the will of the Father. You don't find Isaac protesting when Abraham started binding him up. You don't find Isaac protesting, yelling and bawling and squalling when he lays him on the altar. You don't find Isaac pleading and begging for mercy when Abraham's hand is extended. No, just like Jesus, who was a lamb who was silent before his shears, so also Jesus did not protest before his accusers. He didn't say a word. Isaac was submitted to the will of his father because he knew that if this is what God had called his father to do, that his father was a good man and therefore submitted his will. In the same way, it's no different for us. When we realize the character of God, that God is good no matter what we see, no matter what happens on the earth, no matter what trials or tests we go through, the character of God will carry us through because we know that God is working behind the scenes where we don't even see it. God will take care of your needs. In fact, go ahead, you can give the Lord a praise for that. In fact, we find that after the Lord calls out to Abraham, 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 he stops him from sacrificing his son. That Abraham in that place gets a revelation of the character of God. In fact, it's one of the redemptive names of God that you will find in the Bible. And for the first time, he speaks something forth that no one before him had ever known about God and had ever declared about God. And he says this, look at verse number 14 of Genesis chapter 22. And Abraham called the name of the place, the Lord will provide. You know this as Jehovah Jireh. That when God sees a need, that he will provide. And look at what it goes on to say. As it is said to this day, in the mount of the Lord it shall be provided. See, it was in that same mount that Jesus went to the cross and died for all of us. And it's from that place of sacrifice and from that place of our salvation that now every need that we have is met. It is met in the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. By his stripes, you were healed. God is able to provide according to his riches and glory. How? By Christ Jesus. Everything you need comes from that place of salvation. It flows from the cross into our lives. John chapter 3, verse 16, you know this, say it with me. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Stop right there. He gave his only begotten son. Remember, Isaac was the only begotten son. Here Jesus is his only begotten son. Let's continue. Say it with me. That whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Isaac teaches us with a parable, with a story about the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Faith, when you come to that godly conclusion of faith and you add up all the facts about God and you reconcile and you take the questions to the character of God, and you realize that I may not understand what's going on here in the natural, but I'm not going to produce this in the flesh. I may not see the path, but yet I'm going to trust God and follow him, even if it looks like a detour along the way. Faith will carry you through every test, and it will carry you through every trial. Why? Because we know the character of God, and we know that he is good. Just like a caterpillar has to go into the cocoon before it can ever become a butterfly and fly. You may have to take that seed and drop it in the ground and let it die. Might have to wrap up into darkness and things that are uncomfortable and constricting. But listen, if you don't die, you don't fly. And if you don't want to wrap up in patience and in the promises of God and wait on the Lord, then you can go back to crawling if you want to. And yet God has not called you to the natural crawling around here in the dirt. God wants you to take wings and to go to higher levels than you ever dreamt possible. God wants you to spread your wings and to fly. It comes when you reach that godly conclusion of faith. Last verse for today is this, 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse number 12. For this reason, the Apostle Paul is writing, for this reason I also suffer these things. See, we don't like suffering, do we? No one wants to suffer. No one realizes they're suffering and goes, yes, I was waiting for this. And yet that's the picture the Bible gives us. Count it all joy when you encounter various trials, my brethren, for you know something. For this reason I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed. Why could he say that? For I know whom I have believed. In other words, the Apostle Paul, when he was shipwrecked, beat up, cast out, stoned, left for dead, when people were lying about him, when he was in the deep for 3 days, when he got onto the island and a snake latched onto him, things were happening all around him, when people turned their backs on him and abandoned him, when he ended up in a Roman jail, And no one came and visited him, when no one came to his aid, he added up all the facts and he said, I'm not ashamed at all. I don't feel bad about the place that I'm in. Why? Because I know who I believed. He knew the character of God. He knew that God was faithful and that God was good. And look at this. And I am persuaded that he is able. Remember, Abraham had concluded that God was able. Now here the Apostle Paul comes to the same conclusion. I am persuaded that he is able to keep what I've committed to him until that day. In other words, everything's going to be all right. Because he had reached the godly conclusion of faith. For all of us, we wrestle with many things. And that's okay. It's okay to wrestle. It's okay to have those questions. But don't try and produce it in the natural. Don't try and take the wrong path. And finally, account for the character of God. Did you guys get some from the word of the Lord today? Come on, let's give God a great big praise. Hallelujah. I want to talk to you about your eternal life. It'd be a tragedy if we came into this place. We heard the word of God. We laughed together. We sang together. Had such a good time. You guys felt the presence of God. And then you got up and you left and your heart wasn't right with God. You walked out of those doors. Now listen, there's a bunch of people getting up because I allowed some people, not everyone, but some people to get up and leave. But you guys are going to miss what God wants to speak to you right now about your life. And it'd be a tragedy for you to leave this place. Your heart wasn't right with God and you died. You ended up in hell. I don't want that. I love you too much to see you head for hell. God doesn't want that. He loves you so much, he sent Jesus, beaten, bloody, and hung on a cross. You didn't have to go to hell. And listen, you sure as your life don't want that. So listen up. Give me a couple more minutes of your attention, then I'll let you go. Those of you that are out there in the foyer, you got up and you left, listen up. God wants to speak to you right where you're at right now. So no one get up, no one leave during this time. Give me a couple more minutes of your attention. I'll talk to you about your life. What makes you think you're headed for heaven? Just answer that question in your heart. No one knows the answer but you. And God, what makes you think you're going to heaven? Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, you talked about hell. That's an offensive term to me. I don't like that term. I don't think hell's a real place. I don't think a loving God would send people to hell. Well, he doesn't. A loving God allows us the free will choice while we're here on the earth to choose with our lives where we go. But God is just. And therefore, there is a punishment for sin. And just by saying hell's not real, burying your head in the sand doesn't make it go away. You're going to have to face the reality of it. It's all through the Bible, Old and New Testament. Jesus himself spoke about it. It's a very real place. And you don't have to go there. God is pleading with you right now, giving you an opportunity to change your destiny. But it can't be your way. Can't do it in the flesh. Can't do it in the natural. It's got to be his way. Now, many people have said many things about the way to get to go to heaven. Some people have said, all you have to do is be good. If you can be good enough, you'll get to go to heaven. But yet, you know, the Bible says that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And our goodness compared to God's goodness is like filthy rags. You're going to get thrown out. Sometimes people said, well, all you got to do is be raised in church and your parents tell you you're Christian. Or be born in America, that America's a Christian nation. You know that nowhere in the Bible does it say, parents raised you in church, tell you you're Christian, that makes you a Christian. Nowhere in the Bible say that because you're an American citizen, that guarantees you citizenship in heaven, or that because you're not some other religion that by default, God lumps you into the category of being a Christian headed for heaven? Come on, it doesn't work like that. Sometimes people have said, well, all you got to do is, you know, sit in church. Not only when you were a child, but man, you're sitting in church right now. Well, that's like me saying, I want to be a fish. And so I go sit in the Pacific Ocean, call myself a fish, and expect that that turns me into a fish. You know, not just a person, slimy, pruny, sitting there in the water. Not going to make it. Can't make it to church, can't make it to heaven just by sitting in church calling yourself a Christian. Sometimes people have said, well, you know, if you volunteer in church, if you get involved, if you help out, sing in the choir, carry the pastor's Bible, make decisions, that makes you a Christian headed for heaven. But can I tell you the truth? Nowhere in the Bible do I find God is looking for your volunteer hour sheet. Nowhere in the Bible do I find that God is looking for your membership card to a church before you can enter the gates of heaven. Some have said, well, pastor, I know that God's way is that you just got to know God. Someone told me that if I knew God, I'm a Christian. I know God. I celebrate Christmas and Easter, sing the songs every year of my life. I could quote scriptures. I know God. That's great. You know who else knows God is the demons. They shudder. Why? Because they know their end. They know that they are headed for hell. The devil himself knows who Jesus is, believes he's the Son of God, and can quote scriptures out of his mouth. We saw that from the Word of God today. And yet he's not a Christian. So everybody look up here at me for a second. That's the wrong path. See, if it's only coming out of your head, you're not going to make it. It's not about mental ascent towards God, knowing who Jesus is, and that gets you right with God. You've got to find the path of God, forsaking the way of the flesh and forsaking the wrong path, dying to that and taking into account the character of God. The Bible tells us that the way to heaven is narrow, hard to find, and there's few who find it. Today, let the Holy Spirit be your guide. Let me speak to you and tell you. Let me show you the path. Let me illuminate it for you with the Word of God. Jesus was speaking. Remember, we quoted John chapter 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Jesus was speaking to a man by the name of Nicodemus. He was a religious leader. Good guy. Did a lot of good deeds. In fact, he's probably better than all of us in this room. He got involved in his church, did a lot of good deeds, gave his money. People sang his praises. This guy could quote the scripture. He could debate the scripture. He could sing the scripture. How many of us could do that? And yet when Jesus comes to him, he tells him the way to heaven. He didn't say it was good works. He didn't say it was church attendance. He didn't say it was volunteering or knowing who God is. No, if that was the case, he would have patted him on the back and said, good job, man. I'll see you in heaven. But rather, what does Jesus say? He says, if you want to enter the kingdom of heaven, here's the path. Are you ready for it? He says, you must be born again. Now, again, I'm going to get in your face right now because there's people getting up and walking out. And the devil's trying to distract you and get you off of what God is saying. Don't you think it's a coincidence? People just happen to be getting up when I'm showing you the path? Now, listen, I'm not afraid of your faces. And I may be a nice guy, but let me be like a dad for a second, because my son's over here sitting on the front row, and if he was playing in the street and I saw a truck coming at him, I wouldn't say, oh, son, I love you so much. Could you just walk over here for a minute? It's okay if you want to play in the street. It's all right. Just sometime, if you feel like it, would you come over here? No, I wouldn't say that at all. What would I say? I'd say, son, get out of the road. There's a truck coming. And right now, I love you enough to tell you the truth. Hell is real. And it's headed at you like a Mack truck on the highway. And you need to pay attention to what I'm telling you right now, because if not, you're going to get run over and you'll be a pancake on the highway. This is real. And if you're going to reach that godly conclusion and find the right path, it's not going to be because you went brain dead in church and sat there. It works because you find out the right path. Jesus said the right path is you must be born again. What does that mean? Well, it's always meant the same thing. Same thing for Abraham. Same thing for us today. It's that you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. It's just that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you. Last book of the Bible, book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to a church just like he's speaking to us here in this church today. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. Those are pretty gross and graphic words from the mouth of Jesus. But what's he saying, lukewarm? What's that all about? Well, it's little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again. An occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. You're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, you're not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So today, I'm going to give you an opportunity to do just what we're talking about. Give God all of your heart, give God all of your life. Jesus made this statement. He said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father in heaven. But if you deny me, I will deny you. So today, your call, your choice. Moment, I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two. And when I say three, I'm going to pop my hands together. Bang. When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. You might be thinking, whoa, 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 wait a second. Time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be a little embarrassed. That's okay. Think of the trade-off for a second. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever? No one make that trade. And yet the devil's trying to talk you out of this right now, saying it's emotional, it's fanatical. He was mean to you. But listen, I love you so much that I'll get in your face and look like a fool for Jesus and for you, for your soul, because I want to see you in heaven. God wants to see you in heaven. That's why he sent Jesus beaten, bloody, and hung on a cross. And now Jesus is offering you, will you give him all of your heart, all of your life? He'll give you all of his heart and all of his life in exchange. It's all or nothing. Today, who should raise their hand if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise your hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Come on, today, make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this, never said yes to Jesus, given him all of your heart and all of your life? I'm speaking to you. Finally, who should raise their hand in this place if you're lukewarm like we talked about? Little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer, thinking that that's going to get you into heaven. And yet Jesus says, if that's your heart, I will vomit you out. Listen, you can go all out for Jesus today. Come back. Come back home. Maybe you're like that man that I played guitar with. You had questions. You struggled. And you walked away from God. Today is your day of salvation. Come home. God loves you so much. He's answered your questions. Now, will you give him all of your heart? Will you give him all of your life? All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching my television in the foyer, down at the Love Rock Cafe, come on, put the burger down. Get ready to get your hand up. God's speaking to you right where you're at. If you're watching via the live stream, across the nation and around the world, come on, God sees you. And if you raise your hand, God will acknowledge you right now. And then afterwards, you can minimize your video browser and click the blue button that says respond to God, or go to our homepage, rockchurch.com, and find the tab that says how to know God, and someone will lead you in a prayer. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. If that's you, there's one, two, thank you. Three, got you right there. Three wise people already. There's four, there's five. God bless you. Who else today? There's six, got you up over there. Seven in the family room, got you back there. Seven, eight, nine, thank you. God bless you. Nine, 10, got you right here. My friend, 11, 12, thank you. Who else today? Who else today? No, you need to give God all of your heart. No, you need to give God all of your life. Thank you. There's 13. Got you. Right up front here. Thank you. God bless you. You can put your hand down if I've already seen you. Anybody else that I did not already see? Sitting there wondering if you should do this. Yeah, you should. Today is your day of salvation. Maybe you've wandered off. You backslid. It's time to come home. If that's you, come on. Just lift up your hands today. Anybody else? We got 13 wise people. You won't be alone. And I didn't embarrass them, and I won't embarrass you. Anybody else? I'm going to wrap this up. Anybody else? There's 13 wise people. We're at number 14. Come on, just raise it up high for me when I'm looking your direction. Anybody else? Thank you. God bless you. 14. Come on, 15. Come on, if that's you, just raise up your hand. Anybody else real quick? Number 15, come on. Let's go for God today. If that's you. Anybody else? Anybody else? All right, let's give the Lord a great big praise for 14 wise people. Hallelujah. God is so good. All right. All 14 of you, number 15, 16, 17, 18, or number 19 and 20, you should have raised your hand, but you didn't. Not too late. Once you, in a moment, we're all going to stand, give a clap, give a shout. As we do that, that's your cue to get your stuff, whatever you brought with you to church. You know, your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Get in the aisle and meet me up front, because we're going to change destinies today, but we can't do that until we get you down here. So that, if that's you, you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand. Let's all stand. No one leaves during this time. Come on, let them come. And you just get your stuff. Get a friend if you need a friend. Get in the aisle and meet me up front. We're going to change destinies today. Come on down. Come on down.
Won't you come?
just as you are. They're coming. Let's give them a hand as they come. You can come too. Come on down. From the family rooms, if you want to bring your children down, they'll remember this. Come on down right now if that's you.
Just as you are, oh, come and see.
Come on, come on.
Come receive, come and live.
We'll wait for you. Come on down right now. This is your time. This is your moment.
He'll give you life everlasting.
Hallelujah. You can come too.
He'll give you.
From the foyer, if you raise your hand, come on in right now. This is your time to come on in. Come on down. They're still coming. They're still coming. Come on. Come on, they're still coming. You can come too. We'll wait for you. Come on down. All right, all right. Hey. God bless you guys. Came to give God all of your heart. Came to give God all of your life. This is the best decision you have ever made. That's pretty cool. Man, you can put a smile on your face. This is a good thing. This is not a bad thing, all right? I want to introduce you guys to a friend of mine right over here to my right, your left. This is Pastor Joel waving at you. Really good guy. Nothing weird goes on. You know, sometimes you go to church, you wonder, are they weird? I'm about as weird as you're going to get today, okay? He's cool. He's going to do three things. He's going to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus in your heart. You're going to be born again. Then he's going to give you some free information, some free literature, help you find out what to do next in your walk with God. Now that I'm a Christian, what do I do next? It's easy reading. It's free. Take about 30 minutes if you read slow. Okay? It'll just help you get your bearings on what to do next in your walk with God. I'll give you a hint. Get back to church. Come hang out with us. Get under the Word of God. All right? And then finally, what he's going to do is he's going to introduce you to a program we have here called Spiritual Personal Trainers. You heard of a physical trainer in the gym? Helps you get strong, helps you get buff, right? Okay, spiritual personal trainer will do that for you spiritually. It's a friend in church who will help you get strong in the ways of the Lord so you don't go back serving the devil. Don't go back to the old ways or the flesh, right? But that you go on with God following his path, okay? They'll meet with you for 5 weeks, teach you five things out of the Bible right before a church service. It's easy, it's free, and you need to do it, okay? He'll describe how that works, and then he'll let you come right back out. Okay, your friends and family will wait for you. If you guys will make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel right this way. Let's give him a hand as they go. Come on, hallelujah. Let's give the Lord a great big praise.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow, you repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you. Bye-bye.